After much deliberation, the Greybeards accepted the responsibility of hosting a peace talk between both warring parties in order to get a ceasefire in this war. Many thought it would be impossible for them to find common ground on this, but with the threat of Alduin looming large, it behooved everyone for the Dragonborn to succeed. Every Nord that died thanks to the dragons was a Nord lost to Skyrim and lost to the Stormcloaks. See, in the hypothetical future where they defeat the Empire, they would have to defend themselves against the Thalmor, all by themselves. And if the entirety of Skyrim was burning, well, it didn't really leave much of a future for them. On the Empire side, basically the same reasoning. The weaker Skyrim is, and the more people die during this conflict, the weaker the Empire is overall, and the more powerful the Thalmor become. The only winning party with the Dragonborn not succeeding in this endeavor would be the Thalmor, though probably only momentarily. The end of the world would eventually reach the magical shores of the Somerset Isles, though of course, that being mainly a Nordic myth, doubtful they would understand its real danger. Probably also worth mentioning for the side of the Greybeards that if they actually succeeded in fomenting peace, then they would be succeeding in not only their creed, but to also Parthenax, their leader. But with all of those things in mind, the Dragonborn set out in his new quest to convince these parties to have this conversation. Now, we have talked a little bit about Ulfric's Stormcloak and his quest for the unification of Skyrim. However, we haven't quite worked on General Tullius as of yet. Now, if you remember back in the beginnings of this story, he was present in order to personally see to the execution of Ulfric back in Helgen. See, he is the military governor of Skyrim, which poses a collection of interesting dilemmas and questions. The main one being, well, who actually rules Skyrim? Now, in a perfect world, if none of this nonsense was happening, then you would have what the Nords call a High King. He or she would be considered the leader of Skyrim, as all the Jarls of the province swear fealty to him or her. Now, typically, the position of High King is either for life or until abdication, and the main way to become one is essentially through a hereditary process, meaning the firstborn of the High King will become the new High King. Now, the actual coronation process involves what the Nords call a moot. A moot is a meeting between all the Jarls in Skyrim, where they actually get to vote who becomes the new High King. Like I mentioned before, though, it is basically hereditary, so 99% of the time the Jarls will simply vote for the first son or daughter for the deceased king, for really no reason other than tradition. I did say that the Nords are a very, very traditional people. Now, to select a new Jarl, it is in some ways similar and in many, many ways different. First and foremost, the firstborn will always get dibs on the throne. That much hasn't changed. However, if there is no descendant, then the one who gets to choose who becomes Jarl is the Empire. That's right. Those all the way over in the Imperial City in Cyrodiil actually get to choose who becomes Jarl in such an event. So, as you can see, the influence that the Empire has in Skyrim politics is actually quite large. They get to choose who becomes Jarl, and the Jarls get to choose who becomes High King. One of the biggest reasons why Ulfric Stormcloak always believed that not just the High King, but many of the Jarls were actually always puppets of the Empire. Now, rules in the entirety of the kingdom that the Empire consists of are made by a ruling body called the Elder Council. Jarls sometimes have a place in this council, and the High King always does. So, Skyrim does possess a lot of leeway when it comes to voting and enacting laws in the entirety of the Empire, to be fair. Now, let's get back to the story a little bit. The High King of Skyrim was a man named Torrig. However, he was murdered a little bit before the beginnings of this story by Ulfric Stormcloak. That was the main reason why this.
Ulfric Stormcloak, some here in Helgen call you a hero. But a hero doesn't use a power like the voice to murder his king and usurp his throne,
is said at the beginning of the story. See, the Nords have a very ancient tradition where a Jarl can challenge the High King for leadership of the province. A challenge that cannot be refuted as long as it is made within the High King's halls and in front of his entire court. All of those requisites which were actually met by Ulfric. He challenged the High King and killed him, as it was Nordic tradition. Now, normally a moot would convene now in order to decide who becomes the High King, but Ulfric refuses to participate, as he figured Torik's now widow, Elisif, would be the one becoming High Queen. So what he's doing now instead is conquering hold after hold in order to essentially threaten them into voting for him. This means that currently, Skyrim has no High King or Queen to rule them, and because of that, General Tullius was sent by the Empire to organize and rule in what you could define as kind of martial law. Though he really only rules in matters pertaining to the military, leaving the day-to-day affairs to Jarl Elisif, whom the Empire considers the legitimate inheritor of the title of Queen. In conclusion, Skyrim's Civil War is a match between General Tullius, the master tactician, and Ulfric Stormcloak, a legendary warrior with the power of the voice. And it was these very people that the Dragonborn needed to convince to lay down their weapons for the goodness of the region. But how often does goodness and self-sacrifice come into play in these negotiations? The Dragonborn actually managed to convince these two individuals to attend the meeting. Ulfric, just out of sheer respect for the Greybeards, and Tullius, well, more just out of being generally a reasonable guy.
Jarl Ulfric, General Tullius, this council is unprecedented. We are gathered here at the Dragonborn's request. I ask that you all respect the spirit of High Hrothgar, and do your best to begin the process of achieving a lasting peace in Skyrim. Who would like to open the negotiations?
Yes, let's get down to it. We want control of Markarth. That's our price for agreeing to a truce.
So that's why you're here, Ulfric? You dare to insult the Greybeards by using this council to advance your own position?
Jarl Elisif!
General, this is outrageous. You can't be taking this demand seriously. I thought we were here to discuss a truce.
Elisif, I said I'd handle it.
As for you, General Tullius, I see now that Garmar was right. Talking to the Empire is just as useless as ever. If you think you can hold Markarth, you're as deluded as your Emperor when he signed away our freedom to the Thalmor. Skyrim will never again bow to your false Empire. Let's go, Garmar. I should have listened to you in the first place.
You always were a fool, Ulfric. You're no better at diplomacy than you are in the battlefield.
Stop! Are you so blind to our danger that you can't see past your petty disagreements? Here you sit arguing about nothing, while the fate of the land hangs in the balance.
Is he with you, Delphine? If so, I advise you to tell him to watch his tongue.
He is with me, and I advise you both to listen to what he has to say before you do anything rash.
Don't you understand the danger? Don't you understand what the return of the dragons means? Alduin has returned, the World Eater. Even now he devours the souls of your fallen comrades. He grows more powerful with every soldier slain in your pointless war. Can you not put aside your hatred for even one moment in the face of this mortal danger?
A very pretty speech. But what does it have to do with a...
If he's right about Alduin, we both have just as much to lose here, Tullius. Remember that. Now, back to the matter at hand.
The meeting went as well as it could have, and in a lot of ways as expected. General Tullius was respectable and diplomatic, whereas Ulfric was fiery and explosive. Some concessions had to be made and a lot of land was traded between the two groups, but in the end, the ceasefire was enacted.
It seems we may have an agreement. Jarl Ulfric, General Tullius, these are the terms currently on the table. Markarth will be handed over to Ulfric's forces, Jarl Igmund will step down, and Thangvor Silverblood will become the Jarl of Markarth. The Stormcloaks will withdraw from the Rift, allowing Imperial troops unhindered access. Jarl Leila Lawgiver will step down, and Maven Blackbriar will become the Jarl of Riften. Falkreath will be turned over to Ulfric, and Dengir of Stoon will return as Jarl. You both agree to this?
The Sons of Skyrim will live up to their agreements, as long as the Imperials hold to theirs. What about you, Elisif? Are these terms to your liking? Speak up! I'm sure General Tullius is waiting to do your bidding.
I have nothing to say to that murderer. General, you've proven yourself a good friend to Skyrim. I continue to trust that you will do your utmost to safeguard our interests.
Thank you, Jarl Elisif. I appreciate your loyalty. The Empire can live with these terms, yes, for a temporary truce, until the dragon menace is dealt with. After that, Ulfric, there will be a reckoning. Count on it.
Come on, Galmar. We have a lot of work to do.
Having debated long enough, screamed at each other for long enough, the ceasefire was enacted and all parties were as happy as they could be by the end. Now it was time for the Dragonborn's plan to begin, to attempt to imprison a dragon and coerce it. Thankfully, while the peace talks were being prepared, Esbern had been hard at work at finding a dragon to subdue. Using the draconic knowledge found at Skyhaven Temple, and cross-referencing the map that we found at the beginning in Bleakfall Sparrow, Esbern had found the name of a dragon currently under the command of Alduin, a dragon named Odaving. It had seemed that by merely pronouncing its name out loud, the Dovahkiin could summon the dragon. See, dragon names are shouts in and out of themselves, which would allow the Dragonborn to produce some of that innate magic recorded in them. Especially now that Alduin was defeated, no dragon could ever resist the calling of the Dragonborn for a challenge. But before he enacted his plan, a very sad and unfortunate course of events would unfold, for during their visit to High Hrothgar in the Throat of the World, the Blades had found out who the real leader of the Greybeards was. They had found that Parthenax was a dragon. As I explained before, the Blades are dragon killers, first and foremost, and the biggest reason that dragons were basically extinct was because of them. Coming from a place of hatred and revenge, Delphine gave the Dragonborn an ultimatum. He was to kill Parthenax as revenge for his mistreatment of humans back before the Dragon War. The ultimatum being, if the Dragonborn refused, then the Blades would not help him anymore. Now, this is one of the more touching and deep moments in this story. Truthfully, we actually don't know if the Dragonborn did off with Parthenax or if he allowed him to live. That is a part of the story that maybe one day we will know, but what Parthenax had to say in the matter as a response to knowing that the Blades wanted him dead was rather inspiring.
The Blades are wise not to trust me. Onikan Niov, I would not trust another Dovah. Dov Walan Farel, we were made to dominate. The will to power is in our blood. You feel it in yourself, do you not? I can be trusted. I know this, but they do not. Onikan Niov Dovah, it is always wise to mistrust a Dovah. I have overcome my nature only through meditation and long study of the way of the voice. No day goes by where I am not tempted to return to my inborn nature. Zimgriforvut se sujech. What is better, to be born good, or to overcome your evil nature through great effort?
To overcome your evil nature through great effort. It must have been very difficult. We know that he hated Alduin, for Alduin saw himself as a god, which of course can be difficult for another dragon to swallow, knowing full well that Akatosh is the real god. We also know that the goddess Kinnereth commanded Parthenax to help the humans by teaching them to shout like dragons do, but we don't know if the command was forceful, if she controlled Parthenax and made him do it, or if she simply asked in kind and he accepted. Maybe the goddess Kinnereth saw the good inside Parthenax and that's why she knew to ask him. Or maybe he knew that Alduin was going to fall and fail, and he chose the winning side. Regardless, to fight your own nature, regardless of whatever that nature is, must be extremely difficult. Imagine avoiding eating, even though your entire body commands you to. You know yourself how difficult it is not to scratch when your body itches. All those little emotions. I have great respect for this dragon and what he stands for. Any fight as hard as his must be admired. I like to think personally that the Dragonborn did not kill him. But we do know that there was a spark of evil inside of the Dragonborn after taking in that knowledge pertaining to Dragonrend. There is massive hatred towards dragons now inside of his heart. A lot of it being aimed at Parthenax, for those humans would have hated him too. Never forget that. The Greybeards warned the Dragonborn to avoid taking in such hatred. Poetic it might be that by allowing him to learn the Word of Power that their master would pay the price for it. If you would like to watch the full 2-hour video, then be sure to head on over to patreon.com/MrRhexx, where the video is available to all patrons. Otherwise, stay tuned as we will continue to upload the rest throughout the next couple of weeks every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday. Lastly, I would like to thank Dylan Baker, Toby Oliver, and Alex Fitchie for supporting me on Patreon and allowing this to happen. Thank you very much.